Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Shreya Savijay. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Thursday, the 1st of July. Indian PM Modi lauds contribution of doctors, healthcare workers in fight against COVID. Survival, security and unity of Afghanistan is in danger, says top peace official Abdullah. And Bangladesh imposes strict lockdown amid record surge in COVID-19 cases. And now for all the details. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Thursday addressed the medical fraternity on the occasion of National Doctors' Day and lauded their contribution in the fight against COVID as the pandemic tears through India for the second time since last year. India saw a single-day rise of 48,786 coronavirus infections on Thursday, taking the tally of COVID-19 cases to 30.41 million. As India battles the second wave of the COVID-19 pandemic, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Thursday thanked all doctors and healthcare workers for their exemplary service in fighting COVID for the last 1.5 years, calling it an admirable feat. Addressing medical fraternity on the occasion of National Doctors' Day, the Prime Minister also paid tribute to those who laid down their lives while performing their duties. Admitting that the government has put maximum thrust on healthcare sector, he said budget allocation for the health sector has also been doubled.
आज जब देश कोरोना से इतनी बड़ी जंग लड़ रहा है, तो डॉक्टर्स ने दिन रात मेहनत करके लाखों लोगों का जीवन बचाया है। ये पुण्य कार्य करते हुए देश के कई डॉक्टर्स ने अपना जीवन भी न्योछावर कर दिया। मैं जीवन आहुत करने वाले इन सभी डॉक्टर्स को अपनी विनम्र श्रद्धांजलि अर्पित करता हूं।
Meanwhile, after 3 days of brief respite, the COVID cases and deaths have shown a gradual increase once again. India on Thursday reported 48,786 new COVID-19 infections and 1,005 deaths in last 24 hours. The country has recorded 30.41 million total cases so far. India has administered more than 335 million doses, the most in the world after China and the United States. With the withdrawal of foreign troops from Afghanistan, fighting has worsened across the country, as Taliban insurgents have conducted a wave of offensive in recent days. Abdullah Abdullah, chairman of High Council for National Reconciliation of Afghanistan, at the Council's Leadership Committee meeting on Wednesday, expressed concern over the situation and said the survival and unity of Afghanistan is in danger.
Chairman of the High Council for National Reconciliation, Abdullah Abdullah, at the Council's Leadership Committee meeting at the Afghan Presidential Palace on Wednesday said, the survival, security and unity of Afghanistan is in danger, and there is no better way than peace. Abdullah expressed concern that with the withdrawal of foreign troops from Afghanistan, the war has escalated. Unfortunately, the Taliban side has taken advantage of this and the foreign troop withdrawal has naturally left a vacuum in some areas, he added. The 6th Leadership Committee meeting was attended by Afghan President Ashraf Ghani, council members and other government officials. This comes as Germany's last troops left Afghanistan on Tuesday after nearly 20 years of deployment in the country. On Tuesday, the U.S. Defense Department asked the Taliban to return to the peace negotiations, reminding them that the violence remains too high in Afghanistan.
What we want to see, what we'd like to see, is the Taliban return to the peace process in a credible way. And as we see events on the ground unfold, it certainly calls into question the sincerity of their efforts to be a legitimate, credible participant in the peace process.
Earlier, the commander of foreign forces in Afghanistan, Scott Miller, urged a political settlement in the country, characterizing the current security situation as not good. Peace talks in Doha have largely stalled, officials say, though there have been meetings in recent days, and the Taliban say they are committed to negotiations.
Moving on, Prime Minister of Pakistan-administered Kashmir, Raja Farooq Haider Khan, on Wednesday warned Pakistan's PM Imran Khan against stealing the July 25 election in the illegally occupied region. He said he has apprehensions that Islamabad plans to turn the region into a province or further divide it into parts.
Prime Minister of Pakistan-administered Kashmir Raja Farooq Haider Khan has warned of strong resistance against PM Imran Khan-led Pakistan government's attempts to steal the upcoming general election in the illegally occupied region. Raja Farooq Haider Khan, a senior leader of Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz Party, blamed Imran Khan's Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf Party wants to influence voting in the assembly election on July 25 and turn Pakistan-administered Kashmir into a province or divide it into parts. He said the people in the region will resist any such move and pre-poll rigging, similar to what happened during election in Gilgit-Baltistan last year.
Imran Khan sahab, aap jis agenda par kaam kar rahe hain, azad shahir ke log usko pura nahi hone denge, main bilkul aapko sab jo marzi kar rahe hain aap, aap ulta bhi latak kar aa jaye, aap apne is napak agenda par kabhi jo hai wo kamyab nahi ho sakte aur hum resist karenge usko.
Pakistan PM Imran Khan was accused of pre-poll rigging and influencing voting last year during election in Gilgit-Baltistan after he announced granting of provisional provincial status to the illegally occupied region, a move against UN resolutions.
In news from Nepal, student organizations affiliated to opposition parties on Wednesday held an anti-government protest denouncing the dissolution of the lower house of parliament in May. Opposition parties have continued to oppose the move, calling it unconstitutional and anti-democratic.
Five student organizations affiliated to Nepal's opposition alliance on Wednesday evening burnt effigies of caretaker Prime Minister KP Sharma Oli near the parliament as they returned back to streets of capital Kathmandu denouncing the house dissolution. The protesters chanted slogans against Oli as well as Nepal's president Bidya Devi Bhandari, demanding to scrap what they termed an unconstitutional move. President Bhandari had dissolved the House of Representatives on May 21 on the recommendation of Oli's cabinet and announced midterm elections in November. The move came after neither caretaker PM Oli nor opposition leader Sher Bahadur Deuba were able to demonstrate a majority to form a new government. The protesters demanded resignation of Oli, saying he cannot continue on the Prime Minister's post as he had lost a vote of confidence. The country's Supreme Court has also been hearing a dozen of petitions filed by opposition lawmakers against the House dissolution.
Moving on to news from Bangladesh. The 7-day strict lockdown in Bangladesh began on Thursday in an effort to curb the spread of coronavirus. Bangladesh police officers checked vehicles and army soldiers patrolled streets in capital Dhaka. A record spike in cases this week of the highly contagious Delta variant prompted the government to order a week of tight controls.
Bangladesh police officers checked vehicles and army soldiers patrolled streets in the capital Dhaka as the country entered a strict lockdown on Thursday in an effort to curb the spread of coronavirus. A record spike in cases this week of the highly contagious Delta variant prompted the government to order a week of tight controls, although the measures could be extended. Bangladesh recorded 115 coronavirus deaths on Wednesday, with 14,503 overall and 913,258 cases. A police officer at one checkpoint said only essential goods carriers and ambulances were being permitted to move on the streets.
Ambulance, ponnobahi gari, ei sob gari allow korchi. Ekhane amra kono dhoroner byaktigoto gari jegulo shegulo allow korchi na.
All offices and transportation will be shut during this period, while factories, including the country's prime garment export sector, will be allowed to remain open if they follow health protocols, the government said. Meanwhile, the United States on Tuesday began shipping 2.5 million doses of Moderna's COVID vaccine to the South Asian nation of more than 160 million people, and it is set to arrive in the country by July 3. Mass inoculation campaign has remained stalled for over 2 months after the COVID-19 situation in India drastically deteriorated in March and the vaccine supply was suspended.
As China marked the 100th founding anniversary of its Communist Party on Thursday, exiled Tibetans residing in India held protests criticizing the very existence of CCP and its establishment. Dozens of Tibetans gathered outside Chinese embassy to protest the cruelty and brutality of the CCP and to send the message that they were putting up a united front against it.
Members of the Tibetan Youth Congress on Thursday staged a protest outside the Chinese embassy in Indian capital New Delhi against the centenary celebrations of the CCP, the Chinese Communist Party. Protesters carrying posters shouted slogans as they raised their voice against the Chinese rule in Tibet before being frisked away by the security personnel. CCP was founded in 1921 with the help of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union during a turbulent period after the country had a decade earlier cast off 2,000 years of dynastic rule. The invasion of Tibet by the CCP in 1959 led Tibetan spiritual leader, the 14th Dalai Lama, to escape to India.
We condemn. They are the murderer. They are the killer. So the very existence of CCP is there to the global community. Free Tibet. Jai Tibet, Jai Bharat.
In northern hill town of Dharamsala, exiled Tibetans held a silent protest, where a protester wearing mask of Chinese President Xi Jinping sat in a tub containing red water, representing blood. The protesters also hung effigies on Olympic rings, representing East Turkestan, Hong Kong, Tibet, Taiwan and South Mongolia, to express their anger towards CCP. China has ruled Tibet with an iron fist since troops took over the region in 1959. China fears that any unrest in Tibetan regions could pose a threat to its rule there. The government rejects criticism that it has repressed Tibetan religious freedom and culture, saying its rule has ended serfdom and brought development to a backward region.
A paper mache exhibition has been organized in Srinagar city of India's Jammu and Kashmir to boost the local handicraft industry and promote traditional Kashmiri arts. The exhibition reveals the remarkable versatility of paper mache artists, adding new vocabulary of designs.
A paper mache exhibition has been organized in Srinagar city of India's northern Jammu and Kashmir territory with an aim to promote the traditional Kashmiri arts and boost the handicrafts industry in the valley. Around 16 fragments of paper mache art made by local artisans and renowned contemporary artist Veer Munshi have been put on display at the Arts Emporium, Srinagar. The artworks have been made for an Ahmedabad-based corporate house, but are being exhibited before being shipped. The intent is to uplift traditional paper mache into another level by interpreting it into contemporary language, which can be recognized globally, Munshi said.
We are doing it a collaborative with the artisans of Kashmir, mainly this time paper mache, which is so rich. Which its heritage, its because cultural, it has come from cultural renaissance from over the years. So how we can interpret through an artist and how we can take it further.
The organizers said traditionally papier-mâché has been used to manufacture small painted boxes, balls, trays and other small items only. But this exhibition gives new hope to the artists and encourages younger generation to engage with the rich heritage of craft.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now, viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/sasianewsline and follow us on Twitter at sasianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We'll see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.